Hello and welcome to another episode of BIM 360, the series for success. My name is David Campbell and I brought along with me fellow BIM enthusiast and BIM 360 expert, Joey Whitney.
Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to yet another episode of our BIM 360 series for success. As David said, I'm Joey Whitney and today we're just going to jump into BIM 360 docs. But before we do that, I want to give a quick overview, as we do with every episode, over what BIM 360 is. And you know, for those of you that tune into the previous episodes, the same 2-minute rehash. But for those of you guys that are just now tuning in, it's very important. So BIM 360, what is it? You know, think about an Autodesk collaboration tool in the cloud, but that's all you know. Well, BIM 360 at its core is a series of APIs, or sits on a series of APIs rather, and it's called Forge. Forge allows us to push and pull data between various applications. And then we have what is BIM 360 Document Management, which is what we're going to be talking about today. Document management is that file repository, that single source of truth, that common data environment, whatever you want to call that entity. It's the container where all files get stored. And from there, we have all these various modules that we're going to talk about in future episodes. So without further ado, David's going to jump into BIM 360 Document Management.
All right. All right. So let me go ahead and share my screen. There we go. So with document management, I'm going to start under the folders. Okay. And I'll start with the plans. Now, there are two folders when you open up document management. You're going to see the plans files and the project files. Okay. So I'll go ahead and review the plans and Joey's going to take project files. So with the plan files, when you upload any model into your plan files, you're going to see that it's going to break it down based off of what views are there. Now, this is any file type, whether it's a PDF, it's a RVT, it's a CAD drawing, kind of what have you. It can host any file type here in the plans section. Okay. You're also going to see that as you upload these models, whether you are uploading files or uploading these files as linked files, right? So they're already linked together. You want to show the entire model. What it's going to do is it's going to track these documents as you upload them. So we got version 1, version 2, version 3 here. So it'll kind of track the different versions of that document. Now I'll go back into that here in a minute. But again, you're going to be able to host almost any file type here. Now with these plans files, one big note is you're going to see this coordination folder here. The model coordination module is going to work explicitly off of this plans folder. So when you go to make your coordination spaces, you're going to want to make it inside of the plan folder. So what you'll see is that it actually breaks that model down again, like I said earlier, when you load it up into the different views and sheets that are associated with that model. Maybe if I scroll down, I can find a 3D model here. And then I can go into my 3D model viewer. Now you can view your PDFs in here, your 3D models, your 2D sheets, the views, kind of what have you. It doesn't matter in terms of what you're opening. You're going to be able to see it here. There are different tools that you're going to see in terms of comparison. So you're going to be able to go into like a split view mode. You can do an overlay type of thing to kind of navigate and kind of compare, I want to say, of this model itself based off of the model type. Okay, now inside of this 3D model viewer here, I can navigate around the model. I can actually click on different elements, get property information for these different elements here, and pull metadata from it essentially. I can make markups on it and actually place information back into the model, take measurements as I need to. No matter what process you're in, whether it's design review or constructability, kind of what have you, of this model. Now, one big thing I also like about this is you have a full model browser to go ahead and turn anything on and off to adjusting the visibility of different elements within this browser here. And you got a nice first-person walkthrough. So if I click my first person here, say, okay, got it, I can place them right onto the surface itself and kind of walk around using my either A, W, S, and D, or I can click my mouse and kind of navigate around there and then use my zoom, like my mouse wheel, to kind of navigate and walk around my model, right? I can place markups and again, do that QA kind of QC, maybe do a quality check, make sure everything looks good, and place any markups or create what we like to call issues, right? So if I see something wrong in this document, maybe I notice these two walls are yellow and I want them to be white, I can say create issue, specify the type of issue. Maybe we know this one's going to be a design issue, right? Since I'm in the design itself. What type it is, if I want to put a title to it, if I'm going to assign this to anyone. But here we go. I would go ahead and push it there. Say title, wrong wall material, assign to. We can specify the due date, say tomorrow, root cause, as we kind of talked about earlier, remember? So we talked about that, being able to adjust the root causes and the types of issues that we have. So we can find the root cause, whether this is a design deficiency, what have you, and we can just say, please change to white. Create. And there it is. My new issue has been created. Okay. So if I back out of this view here, again, you're going to see it's going to change based off of whatever type of model you're viewing, whether you're viewing a Navis model, a Revit model, or a PDF. Now, a good note for PDFs would be that as you guys go to upload these PDFs, you'll kind of notice that a lot of these different PDFs have information. Let's say I'm going to back out of this one here. They are still pulling information here in terms of what title, what the version is, when it was last updated, if it has any markups on it. And you're going to see these are called attributes. Okay. We even have a level of fun over here. Attributes on these documents themselves. For Revit models and things like that, you're going to notice that BIM 360, when we pull it up into Docs, it's going to pull that information from that, the title of the view, the title of the model, that kind of stuff. With a PDF, it's a little bit harder. What we want to do is we want to utilize the title block itself to pull data from that PDF. So we'll create these different title blocks, and what we'll do is specify areas within that title block of information. So here you're going to see I have my different fields for the number and the title here. And I just specify down below here where I want to pull that information from. So essentially, just like in Bluebeam, when you're doing a plan region, you want to just draw that around, or even in Revit, as you're doing a plan region itself, you're cropping, you're going to draw that around and just tell it where to look, right? So that's kind of what we're doing there. So that's how we adjust those title blocks and get it to pull these attributes in here for these PDFs. Now, speaking of those attributes, if you click on these three dots next to any of these folders here in Docs, you'll notice it gives us a little more capability, not only just to add new subfolders. So if I know that I want to create more subfolders beneath my plans or in the community center itself, if I wanted to add new subfolders there, allowing coordination, I can. And then I can also go through and adjust the permissions on those folders. So I can activate the permissions of just that subfolder, of the parent folder itself, kind of what have you here. Okay. So also with that, as I was kind of talking earlier, you can add more custom attributes here to pull more information from your models or from those PDFs. So if you have a lot more information in those title blocks, you can add these custom attributes and pull more information into what you're going to see here in your overall kind of title screen, right? Whether you want to share these documents. So if you want to share the document itself, so you want to share to different members within the project itself, you can go in here and share the email or a link to this. Okay. Also here is going to be the subscribe button. I really like the subscribe for if you want to keep tabs right on any folder or any models that you're kind of watching within this. You can subscribe to that folder, and anytime anything's updated, it's going to give you that kind of a notification, right? Letting you know, hey, this is what's going on. Submit for review. So we talked about this earlier in the project admin. If you want to make a review process, you want to utilize the project admin there to go ahead and make that review process. And maybe I want to go ahead and grab my coordination, maybe this school. And if I want to submit this for review, you're going to see it's going to ask me to choose what that review workflow is, whether it's a design approval, it's an RFI, anything like that, what the name of it is, what documents you're including, and again, who's included on this review process itself. Now, you're also going to see here the review tab. This is where we can go to actually check out what reviews are open. So the review tab is going to give us a nice little log of what reviews, what documents and things like that are involved in that different in those open processes. Okay. The next one there was actually to create a transmittal. So if we choose to create a transmittal, maybe say from this coordination folder, we're going to say who's getting the transmittal, what permissions they can have with it, like the view permissions, and what documents that you're going to have with there and the message that you want to send. So if we go to the transmittal log, we'll see I have recently sent one to Joey, and I can actually download the zip file that includes all of the documents from that, and whether they're revisions, they're your 30%, you know, CD, DD, kind of what have you. And then at the end, I don't know why I'm clicking on my waffle over there, but in the end here on issues, this is where we can get a nice little log of the different issues that are going on within our project itself. We can kind of adjust the templates, and as Joey and I were talking about earlier, there are different ways to create issues inside of Docs. So you're going to see one way I showed you guys in the plan file there, and I created an issue and I just placed it right on the sheet. Here is where you can actually create an issue without placing it in that sheet and choose. See, this could be a non-design related issue, right? So whether this is commissioning, it's clash, it's coordination, it's a existing condition, safety, kind of what have you, we can choose the type of issue that this is going to be. And then again, go throughout our entire process of assigning it and specifying the due date, things like that, linking documents as you need to. Okay.
And those issues are really important because that ties into something we're going to talk about a little bit later with the predictive analytics and stuff that mm-hmm. feeds into that. So really dialing in the issue type is really important in the root cause and all that sort of stuff.
It is. I couldn't agree more. Definitely. Especially as you said, when we were going into the analytics of it, as you can track where those root causes of the issues are coming from, or if you know that this specific person or group that you're working for has a track record of having this many issues, things like that. We know that maybe the next project that we do, we know what to expect. All right. So I think that I think that wraps it up. Nope. You know what? One more thing I want to cover before I give it up. Sets. So you guys will notice that some of these documents are included in sets. Sets are really just a way for you to group these documents together, whether they're a new revision, whether they're in a different phase or what have you. Just as you're uploading these new types of documents, you can group them together into what are called sets. All right. And I think Joey's going to take the project files of this.
Yes, sir. All right. So, David, you did a great job of covering the plan section, but I got to show where the real power lives, and that's the project section, guys. So if you notice here, we've got project files here, right? David covered plans. And just like plans, we have a lot of similar functionality. Now, the one, you know, downside, or I guess two downsides is, you know, the model coordination. Yeah, it doesn't happen in project files. It all happens in plans. The other downside, all that great sheet extraction that David mentioned where he'd upload a Revit model and it'd break out all the sheets and views that were published, we don't have that functionality here in project files. So project files is more about storing whole documents, not necessarily sharing individual sheets. That said, we do have a lot of the same great functionality. So David mentioned, you know, so we've got these same three dots, right? The project files and the plan section are the only things that come hard locked. All these other files we created or were created because we, you know, set up design teams or coordination or whatever it was. And like we mentioned earlier in our previous one, you can template the folders so that every project starts the same folders and all that sort of stuff. But if you want to create subfolders, right? So I've got this civil team, right? But maybe I wanted to create a subfolder. Same thing. David mentioned this earlier. I can create subfolders so that everybody can access You know, I can actually break down the access of who I want and what folder structure. Maybe there's under civil team, it encompasses a survey team as well. Or maybe we broke up the civil team into transportation and, you know, topographic or whatever it is. And then any like, just like the plan section, any permissions we apply at the top level get carried to the bottom level. We can edit as we need be. Same add attributes, all the same stuff that David mentioned earlier. But some key differentiators here, right? So David gets coordination, you know, that's cool, but we get design. So BIM 360 design is awesome. I'm a big fan, and they just keep building out even more. So, you know, we've had Revit in the cloud for quite some time under collaboration for Revit. Then they moved it over here to BIM 360 design, but now BIM 360 design goes even further. We can work with civil 3D files in the cloud. We can now work with plant 3D files in the cloud. All in a collaborative environment, all using, you know, that common data environment, if you will. But it all uses this collaborative functionality. But that's not where it ends, right? That's the collaboration aspect. You don't just have to rely on the design piece. BIM 360 Docs has its own collaboration aspects, and it all lives inside this project section. So as David mentioned earlier with, you know, the whole BIM 360, file sharing, all that stuff. We can view files, we can do all that stuff. But under projects, we get a little more cool functionality. I don't have this under the plan section, but underneath the project section, I can do what is check-in, check-out. So if you're familiar using Autodesk Vault, where you've used check-in, check-out capabilities in the past, we can do similar functionalities, not quite as robust as, you know, setting up the IT server stuff, all that, blah, 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 blah. But I can do this cool stuff in the cloud. I can click my file. I can download the source file. I can lock it. Once it's locked, nobody can make any changes. Then I can make my changes, unlock it, re-upload. Really cool functionality. And then again, you got a lot of the same functionality that the plan section has. We, you know, delete, edit assignments, attribute values, you know, submit for review, transmittals, blah, 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 blah. It's all there, right? Uploading files, linked files, it's all there. I did want to show you guys some cool things real quick. So just like in the BIM 360 plan section, BIM 360 Docs plan section, we have similar versioning control functionality, right? We have the same markups, RFIs, issue tracking, all that sort of stuff. Well, technically RFI lives in a different module, but we can talk about that another time. But issues and markups, right? So it keeps that same, you know, log, that same history, keeps that same version control. But something really cool about version control is we can actually compare versions, not just PDFs, not just CAD files, but Revit files. So there's some really cool stuff there where we can just compare and get in there, and I won't run it just a second because I don't want to bog down my machine with Microsoft Teams and all that fun stuff. But so I just, I already ran this a few seconds ago. I've got it pulled up. It's going to tell me, you know, it's been added, removed, or modified. What it does, it actually, this is a Revit file. So it knows that the discipline of the Revit model, it knows that, you know, it's architectural, structural, all that sort of stuff. I can come in here, I can actually, you know, dial in and do some deep dives. I can toggle off certain things. So, you know, maybe I want to know what's changed between, you know, these specific things. I can toggle off architectural and just leave structural. I can look at the modification types. I can further break this down and filter it in any way that I want. Again, this lives in the plan section as well as the project section. But before I end this and turn this back over, I do want to highlight the, you know, one really cool functionality that David, you don't have in plans, but we have in projects. So let me navigate to a file, right? So David mentioned that we can host, you know, pretty much any file format that we want, but we can view specific files formats too. I think there's like 60 or 70 different file formats we can view in here. You'll notice I am looking at an Excel file. If I were to click this, it would launch Excel. I can do version control. But a really cool tool that we have with just the project section, not plans, is this thing called Desktop Connector. What Desktop Connector is it is a mapped drive. So think about it like your Dropbox or whatever, or your OneDrive, where you've got a mapped drive on your desktop where you're syncing in between. It's similar in that regard. So I will navigate to my complete project example, this file right here. They match complete project example. I'm under project files. I'm in my schedule. I'm going to open this Excel file. It's going to launch Excel. And you're going to notice a few cool things here. I am going to be able to manipulate this, save it back, and it is going to version control that right there. And if this was a CAD file, we'd be able to, or a PDF file, we'd be able to actually see what's been changed, modified, or removed between the different files. So let's just go ahead and say, you know what? Dave told me he's taking off on Friday. Typical Dave, never sticks around. So let's come in here. We'll click save. Let's close out of this. And then we'll come in here. We'll do a quick refresh. We'll just jump out of that folder and we'll jump back in. Oh, maybe we'll give it an extra second, right? Love technology, right, guys?
Oh, yes.
All right. I think I just jumped the gun. I let it go a little, you know, expect a little too much. But there it is, as you can see, version 2. Now this is an Excel file, so I can't compare. But again, if it was a PDF or CAD file, a Revit file, I'd be able to do that compare that I did earlier on the Revit model. And I can roll this back to previous versions, upload the source file, you know, download the source files for each, all that sort of stuff. So here I can make the old version current if I didn't like the new version. So it's just a great tool for keeping track and collaborating with all stakeholders on the project, keeping files up to date. So as we said earlier, BIM 360, the key focus of it is that single source of truth, that common data environment, that you know, file repository to end all file repositories, right? We want to track every file format, version control everything, and compare where possible. So with that, though, I just want to thank you guys for your time. You guys have been outstanding, as usual, and I can't wait for the next episode.
Yeah, look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Everybody have a good day.